Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you very much for how you have started with us. We thank you for the encouragement you have been giving us. Thank you for the truth you have been revealing to our hearts. Thank you because of the courage, the boldness of faith that you are imparting into our hearts. Thank you for the example of Paul the Apostle. Thank you for the writings, holy writings, preserved by your Spirit through his instrumentality. Thank you for the way you are helping us to see others have gone before us. We can follow in their footsteps. They overcame, they conquered, they bore fruit, and now they are in your presence. We too, we can overcome. We can bear fruit. We can conquer, and eventually we'll be in your presence. We pray that all the grace we need, you'll grant unto us, so that we'll do what you want us to do, live the way you want us to live, and accomplish the goal you have set before us. Lead us into the study today again. In Jesus' name we pray. We come to the final chapter of 2 Timothy. And in coming to the final chapter of 2 Timothy, we're coming to the very last words of Paul the Apostle, inspired by the Spirit of God. His life was coming to an end. He was in a Roman dungeon in the prison. And he knew, as the champion proclaimer of the truth, that the Roman people and the Jewish people saw as the greatest enemy. One of the champions among the people that have turned the world upside down. They feared him. They feared his message. They feared the consequence of what he was proclaiming to them. And eventually, the height of hatred that they should have manifested to the Lord Jesus Christ, while he is still here in the world. They saw Paul the Apostle as one of his greatest representatives, and therefore they now unleashed every evil and hatred, animosity and cruelty that they would have heaped upon Jesus Christ. They brought everything upon him. And as he was languishing in jail, he knew that the time of leaving this world was very near. His ministry was coming to an end. And you can see from the wordings of chapter 4, look at verse 6, I am now ready, he was telling Timothy, to be offered. He looked at his life as an offering unto the Lord. And you know that Paul the Apostle was a student of the Old Testament. He knew about the drink offering that was to be poured out unto the Lord. He knew about the burnt offering that was to be burnt to ascend unto the Lord with sweet smelling savor. He knew the kind of offering the Old Testament people had. And now he was telling Timothy, he said, my whole life has been an offering unto the Lord. And the last bit of it now is about to be offered unto the Lord. And he said, but it's not going to take me by surprise. I am now ready. I look at my heart. I look at my disposition. I look at the expectation of the Lord in my life. I looked at the ministry before me when I got started. I look at the thing that the Lord wanted me to do. I looked at the areas I should have covered. I examined where I was, where I was to go, where I am now, and what the Lord will be asking me when I appear in His presence. And I can tell you, Timothy, there is no regret in me, and there is no confusion within, and there is no condemnation, as if maybe there is something I should have done which I didn't do. Timothy, I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. And then he says in verse 7, I have fought a good fight. It's been a fight since I became born again, and there's not been a day, a moment when there was not something to contend for. I needed to contend even with Satan, principalities and powers. I needed to contend against the Jewish religion. I needed to contend against the Mosaic law, the continuation of the Mosaic law being brought into the new covenant. I needed to contend against the ideas and ideologies and the philosophies of the time. But it has been a good fight. Fighting to defend the gospel. Fighting to proclaim the absolute truth that we need, that will take us to heaven. And he said, I have done it. I fought a good fight. I have finished my course. It was his intention at the beginning. In fact, he said, I do not count my life as anything. There is only one thing, that I might finish the course, the race that is set before me. He said, that was my intention then. That was my expectation then. That was my desire then. That was my passion then. But now I can tell you, Timothy, I have finished my course. Then he said, I have kept the faith. False doctrine tried to get in, but I kept the faith. And the philosophies of men tried to get in, but I have kept the faith. The Judaizers were not slow about it at all. They wanted Jesus, and the ceremonial people did not. They wanted Jesus, but Jesus and ceremony. Jesus and Judaism. Jesus and philosophy. Jesus and another thing. But Timothy, you know what I've done? I've kept the faith once delivered unto the saints. And now he says, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. He said, Timothy, what do you think about it? Because I have worn the crown of thorns, so to say. I have borne the cross, so to say. I have gone all the way, so to say. And after the cross, there must be a crown. And therefore, he said, henceforth now, from now, anytime from now, you see, I'll be going, a crown of righteousness is laid up for me. In fact, he said, Timothy, you know what? If you do not hurry up, you're not going to see me again, because I would have crossed to the other side before you come. That's why I said in verse 9, do thy diligence to come unto me shortly. He said, I'm ready. I'm about going. My loads are packed. My mind is there. My eyes are watching. I'm looking at my Savior. And like Stephen, when he was about to die, he looked up and he saw Jesus Christ standing at the right hand of God. He said, Timothy, hurry up. If you don't hurry up, you'll not meet me here. In fact, I see my crown. I see the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. Timothy, not to me only. If you love his appearing, and then our friends Titus and Tychicus and Luke and Mark and all the other people, if they love his appearing, are the people that will come in generations to come, and to all that love is appearing. And so as we look at this, we're looking at the final words of a champion of faith, of an apostle who really served the Lord. And what a wonderful thing it is to listen to the last words of people who have spent their lives for something. They knew the Lord called them for, and then they are going away, and there is no condemnation, and they are still retaining the conviction, and there is no fear in them that they are going to meet the Lord unprepared. There was still faith in them. And so he was talking to Timothy and telling him the very final things. Now, as you look at this chapter, you'll find that there are imperatives.
That means commandments. And you look at the whole epistle itself, you find there are commandments there, imperatives there, but I don't have the time to go through all those commandments. Let me just point 7 things to you in the introduction. Before we go into the real study of the chapter, he gives him commandments. What are the commandments? Number 1, preach the word. That's in verse 2. He said, Timothy, the last thing I want to leave with you, the last command I want to leave with you, preach the word. Number 2, he said, do it in season and out of season. He was saying, Timothy and all the other ministers that will follow, he said, you will do it when it is convenient, and when it is not convenient, whatever the cost might be. Number 3, he said, reprove, rebuke, exhort. That means you will correct the misconduct of the people in the church. You will discipline the compromisers, and then you will restore the people that are penitent. Number 4, he said, watch in all things. Watch in all things. So find that in verse 5. Be vigilant, he said, over your life. Be vigilant over your calling, and be vigilant over the doctrine, and be vigilant over your relationships. And then number 5, endure afflictions. It's going to be there. The suffering is part of it. The persecution is part of it. The affliction is part of it. The inconveniences, they are part of it. Therefore, he said, endure afflictions that will come with the ministry. Number 6, he said, do the work of an evangelist, bringing the lost wherever they are found to Christ, the only Savior. Number 7, make full proof of thy ministry. As God has enabled me, Paul, by his grace to do, you too, Timothy, you can do it. And in telling Timothy, he's telling you and telling me, he's telling us we must make full proof of our ministry. And now, as we look at this chapter, you will see something very significant. It's the place of preaching. The place of preaching in the ministry of the church and in the fulfillment of the Great Commission is central. Preaching is central in the fulfillment of the Great Commission. In the work that the church is doing, preaching is central. Therefore, the priority of the church should be preaching. The center of the activities of the church should be preaching. The thing that the church should take care of and protect and guard and not allow anything to conflict with is preaching. The thing that the church should give time to, enough time, adequate time, the thing we should give time to is preaching. Because without the preaching, without making it central, essential, important in the ministry, we will not be able to fulfill the ministry. And so he left the last words with Timothy. He said, Timothy, preaching is central. Preach the word. There's nothing else to preach. Therefore, the role of the preacher is very vital. In fact, the spiritual life and the eternal destiny of members of a congregation somehow depends on the life and the faithfulness of their pastor. Isn't that what the scripture says in Romans chapter 10, reading from verses 13 and 14? Romans chapter 10 from verse 13. And for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Then comes the question in verse 14. How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed? In whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Therefore, you see, the life of the preacher, the faithfulness of the preacher, the pastor, is very, very important. The message of this chapter, then, should be dear to the heart of every preacher. We're not going to look at the chapter in detail, but you'll find out as I divide the chapter. Point 1 will be verses 1 to 5. That will be the scope and the seriousness of our commission. The scope and the seriousness of our commission. Point number 2, sacrificial service before the crown. Sacrificial service before the crown, verses 6 to 8. Then, point 3, saints and sinners in the life of a conqueror. Saints and sinners in the life of a conqueror. Before I go into the explanation and the application of the verses, I need to point something out to you, because you are preachers of the word. And I need to say this so that you'll pray and God will give you wisdom when you preach. Now, if you look at this chapter 4, you look at verses 1 to 5. I said I'm making that one point. Then you look at verses 6 to 8, and I say I'm making that point 2. And then you look at verses 9 to 22, and I say I'm making that point 3. You're going to see something immediately as you look at the division. Point 1 has 5 verses, and point 2 has how many verses? 3 verses. And point 3 has how many verses? All right, it's going to take you time. It has 14 verses. That is verse 9 to verse 22. Now you will see that I've not divided them equally. And it's very obvious when you look at the passage. Because you look at the passage, and the first part is telling you the very central thing there is to do. And even if you don't do any other thing, if you don't preach on any other thing, when you are talking to ministers, emphasize it, preach the word. And if all the time we have this morning is on verses 1 to 5, I think we've done something. But then, point 2 is talking about the testimony, the assurance, the confidence, and the faith of Paul the Apostle. He said, I have fought. He said, I have finished. He said, I have kept. He said, there is laid up for me a crown. And then it is not for me only. It is for all them that love is appearing. He's giving his testimony, and that's important for us. We want to know he has finished, and we want to be able to check up what will our last words be by the time we will be going. And then you look at point number 3, he's saying, Timothy, although I know that I'm going up there, I like to see you and give you the final instruction by word of mouth before I go. Do that diligence to come unto me shortly. And then he's talking about Demas. You don't want to take all the time with Demas. In verse 11, he's talking about Luke. He's saying he's with me. In verse 11, he's talking about Mark. You should bring him along. And in verse 12, he's saying Tychicus, I've sent to Ephesus. And then he's talking about the cloak that he wants him to bring. He left at Troas. He's talking about Alexander the coppersmith that has resisted the word of the Lord. He's talking about all the people in Asia Minor that have forsaken him. And then he's also talking about his friends and his co-laborers. In verse 19, Priscilla and Aquila. He's talking about Onesiphorus, Erastus, at Corinth, and Trophimus. And then he's talking about Eubulus, and then some people we've never met in the New Testament. We're meeting them for the first time at the latter part of verse 21. And the Pudens and the Linus and Claudia and all the brethren. And then he says, the grace of the Lord be with you. Now you see then why we are not giving too much time to the list of those names. And yet we believe all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for correction, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, fully equipped, and thoroughly prepared, furnished unto all good works. We're not going to give the same time. You know, sometimes when a preacher is preaching, he spends a lot of time on point 1. There's a reason for that. He spends a lot of time on point 2. There's a reason for that. And then he spends a little time with point 3. And you say, is the preacher forgetting himself? Has he forgotten that he's going to point 3 and he's spending all the time on point 1? That's what I'm doing today. So that if I spend too much time on point 1, I know what I'm doing. If I spend much time on point 2, I know what I'm doing. And then when I come to point 3, and then I run through in about 5, 7, 8 minutes, you see now, if he had not spent so much time in point 1, he would have had enough time on point 3. See what we're saying now? I think during the question time, I'm going to raise up my hand and ask him. Now, therefore, you understand, it's not a mistake at all. I'm going to do it deliberately. Do you understand? Now we're going to point number 1, the scope and the seriousness of our commission. In verse 1, verse 1 is very, very serious. Again, I want to remind you that Paul was very familiar with Timothy. But then, he didn't bring the familiarity and the intimacy into the instruction. the commandment, the imperative that was given unto him. In verse 1, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. It's just like today. In those olden days, whenever a minister of state was being sworn into office in the presence of magistrates and a chief judge, it was a serious matter, a solemn affair. And Paul the apostle is bringing that kind of situation, or kind of, that kind of imagery, into what he was saying. He pictures a situation with greater solemnity and with serious implications. And the solemnity of the charge is based on the fact that it is tied directly to the awesome majesty of the infinitely great judge who commissions us to divine service. Therefore, he said, Timothy, familiarity apart, intimacy apart, child, father, parent, son, relationship apart, a friendly kind of communication apart, hand in hand together, and saying, would you mind doing this? Would you mind being in the ministry? Would you mind preaching the word? He said, I cannot do that now. Intimacy, friendship, fellowship, familiarity, all apart. We are before the great church, and it is a solemn affair. And Timothy, I'm charging you before God, the judge of all, and the whole earth will appear before him, and everything we have done will be scrutinized by him. And he's going to look at every detail. He's going to look at the way you performed in the ministry. He's going to look at your motive. He's going to look at your disposition. He's going to look at your faithfulness. He's going to judge you. And all the people that you may be afraid of today, they will not matter on that final day. Therefore, Timothy, I charge you before the Almighty God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. He introduced what he wanted to say with that solemn charge, because he wanted him to understand that before the call, and at the time of the call, and even every moment after the call, each of us is in the presence of God, who sees and knows all things. And every minister constantly must be ministering under the omniscient scrutiny of the great judge of heaven and earth. He knows all things. He knows what we say. He knows what we do not say. He knows the reason for saying what we say. He knows the motive for saying what we say. He knows the intention of preaching what we are preaching. He knows whether that preaching is superficial or coming from the depths of our heart. He knows whether we're seeking the glory of God or not. He knows whether we are seeking or we are preaching to please men or not. He knows whether we are preaching to attack a member of the congregation or not. He knows whether we have the Lord always before us. When we are preaching, he knows whether we have that in our mind or not. He knows whether we are trying to attract some people to ourselves or whether we are attracting them to Christ. He knows the differences. He sees everything within, without, the things that are visible, the things that are not visible to the eyes of men, the things that are known and the things that are not known. He said, therefore, forget about me. Forget about the people you fear. Forget about the people that you are trying to please. I charge you before God, the great judge. And I charge you before Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead. The quick there means the living. And the dead, the people who have died, and then when Jesus comes, they'll be raised up and they'll appear before the judgment seat of Christ. He will judge them at his appearing. Then our service, we must understand, is done under the watching eyes of the one who shall judge the living and the dead. And therefore you always tremble. You always say, although I'm preaching to the congregation, But it is the Lord that is looking at what I'm preaching, that will say whether it is right or not right, and I'll be willing to submit everything before him. And whatever God does not approve of, I must be wise enough, humble enough, intelligent enough, careful enough to be able to strike it off. And if God wants you to say something and preach something so that you can perfect the saints, no matter what the reaction of the people will be, you are not preaching for the sake of the people in a way. You are preaching with the omniscient God watching you, scrutinizing you, examining you. And he is the one that will judge you on the final day. Therefore, every message you give, every talk you give, every teaching you give, you say, oh Lord, is this acceptable to you? How will the Lord look at this on the judgment day? Will he say, it's well done, it's the way I wanted it to have been done? That's the important thing here. Now, he gives him what the commandment, the imperative, the instruction that he needed at this time. Verse 2, preach the word. There's nothing else to preach. Preach the word. Don't talk about yourself. Preach the word. Don't give us ancient history, modern history that will not save the soul. Preach the word. Don't talk about, fables and things that may interest people, may entertain people. The people may like it and they may think that, well, that man is a humorous preacher. That fellow, he just takes on the congregation and, you know, you just laugh, you adjust at ease, he's just a nice, effective communicator. Communicate the word. Preach the word. There's nothing else. In fact, if you look at this epistle, he has been talking about the word. And he calls the word various names. Please, you are going to bear with me. In 2 Timothy, we're going to run through a little. From chapter 1, I'm reading verse 10. And you will see what was telling him to preach. You will see what was calling the word. It says, but now, chapter 1, verse 10. But now, is now made manifest by the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. That's what we are to preach. The word here is referred to as the gospel. Look at verse 13. Hold fast the form of sound words, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. That's the word. That's what was telling Timothy to preach. He said the form of sound doctrine, not something rotten, not something modified, not something watered down, not something adulterated. He said, the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and in love, which is in Christ. That is the word he was telling him to preach. Then in chapter 2, verse 2, and the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses. He said, Timothy, have you heard about repentance since you have been moving with me? The things which you have heard among many witnesses. Have you heard about justification by faith? The things which you have heard among many witnesses. Have you heard about sanctification? Have you heard about the death of the old man? Have you heard about the circumcision of the heart? Have you heard about the purity of life? Have you heard about the inner love that is shed in our heart by the Holy Ghost? The things you have heard of me. Have you heard about restitution? Herein do I always exercise myself to have a good conscience before God and before men. Have you heard about one man, one wife being together, no divorce, no separation, until death do us part? Have you heard about it? Have you heard about the evangelism? I'm not ashamed to preach the gospel unto the people that are in Rome, because it is the power of God unto salvation to all the people that believe. Have you heard about that evangelism? The things you have heard of me among many witnesses. Have you heard about the power of the Holy Ghost, the baptism in the Holy Ghost? Have you heard about the rapture, that Jesus Christ will come, the dead in Christ will rise, and we which are alive will be caught up together with them? Have you heard about the great tribulation? Have you heard about the Antichrist? Have you heard about the second coming of the Lord? Have you heard about the establishment of the millennial reign of the Lord? Have you heard about the eternal punishment in hell for the people that die in sin? Have you heard about heaven, the new heavens and the new earth? Everything you have heard from me, he told Timothy, he said, preach it. That's what he meant when he said, preach the word, the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses. Look at what he calls this in chapter 2 and in verse 9. It says, when with wearing I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God. That's what we are to preach. The word of God is not bound. And then he calls it another name in verse 15. Chapter 2 verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's what you are to preach. And then in chapter 2 verse 18, it says, who concerning the truth have erred, and they're saying the resurrection is past already, overthrowing the faith of some. Here he calls it the truth, absolute truth, the heaven-sent truth, the gospel truth, the truth that cannot be adjusted, cannot be modified, is coming from the very throne of God. It has come unto us, and we have no right tampering with it or changing it. In chapter 3 verse 15, he calls it the holy scriptures, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. In verse 16, he calls it all scripture. He said, that's what we are to preach. It says, preach the word. That is, preach the gospel. Preach sound words. Preach the things that you have heard of me. Preach the word of God. Preach the word of truth. Preach the truth. Preach the holy scriptures. Preach all scripture. And so he was telling Timothy. And in telling Timothy, he's telling you and telling me. And he's telling us that we need to preach. When you pick up that word preach, there are times the word preached is used in a narrow sense. But there is a time, there are ways in which, or there are times you use the word preach in a very extensive manner. And as you look at the New Testament, it is in the extensive manner he is taking this word preach. When he said, preach the word, the word preach means to proclaim publicly. Proclaim publicly. But then as we analyze it in the scriptures, please follow and see six things incorporated, included inside that preaching. Number one, it means convince, convict, compel sinners to repent. That's the preaching. That's what you are to do. When it says preach the word, talk to the sinners. Proclaim the truth to the sinners in a convincing manner, in a convicting manner, in a compelling manner, that the people who are listening to you will want to repent. You'll compel them to repent, because without that repentance, they will not be able to get to the kingdom of God. In Mark chapter 1, Mark chapter 1, reading from verse 14 and verse 15. Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying in his preaching, this is what he did, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Preaching then includes convincing, convicting, compelling sinners to repent. Number two, it includes warning hardened sinners of the judgment to come. Warning hardened sinners of the judgment to come. That's what Jonah did when the Lord told him to preach in Nineveh, in Jonah chapter 3, reading from verse 2 and verse 3. It says, arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. And what was he doing? He entered, look at verse 4 now, and Jonah began to enter into the city, a day's journey. And he cried and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. He preached it so convincingly. He preached it, he proclaimed it in such a compelling manner that from the top to the bottom, from the greatest to the lowest, they came off their pleasure and they repented of their sin. Those people were hardened sinners, but Jonah preached to those hardened sinners of the judgment of God. So when the word of God says, preach the word, it's telling you to warn the hardened sinners. Number three, it is presenting. Presenting Christ as Savior in a desirable and acceptable manner. That's what it means to preach. You are presenting Jesus Christ as Savior, but you do it in a desirable manner. You do it in an acceptable manner. In Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, reading from verse 35. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. That's preaching. He had read the scripture in Isaiah, and now Philip started from that same scripture, and he presented Jesus Christ to him in a desirable, acceptable manner. And the man gave his life to the Lord and became soundly saved, soundly converted. Number four, it's instructing the ignorant in the truth of God's word. That's preaching. Instructing the ignorant in the truth of God's word. That ignorant person may be a sinner, instruct him. That ignorant person may be a new convert, instruct him. That ignorant person may even be a worker. He knows a lot of things, but in an area he is ignorant, instruct him. That is part of preaching. In Romans chapter 2, Romans chapter 2, reading from verse 20. An instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which has the form of knowledge and of the truth in the law. You see here, it's talking about teaching the people, preaching to the people, proclaiming to the people that actually do not have enough understanding or enough knowledge. Number five, it's opening the eye of the mind to see eternal realities. That's what preaching is all about. It's not just shouting. It's not just stringing verses together. It's not just saying something, mumbling something. It's not just taking one whole hour and engaging the congregation in listening to something, listening to testimonies, or listening to whatever. It is opening the eye of the mind that the people that didn't see eternal verities, eternal truth, eternal realities before, you open the eyes of the mind to see eternal truth. Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, reading from verse 18, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Number six, it means teaching to lead believers to maturity and perfection. That's preaching. You are teaching to lead the believers into maturity and perfection. Understand that, include that in your preaching. In Colossians chapter 1 verse 28. Colossians chapter 1 verse 28. Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That's the purpose of preaching. That's the goal of preaching. That's your role, that's your function when you preach. When you preach to sinners, you want to compel them, convict them, convince them to repent. When you preach to sinners, you warn them of the judgment of God. When you present Jesus Christ to the people that are awakened, they are now, they have not been born again, but they are waking to the realization that if something is not done, they will be lost. Then you'll be presenting Jesus to them as their Savior, the final sacrifice, the substitute. But you do it in such an acceptable, desirable manner. And then if there are religious people who are full of religious ideas and ideologies, they are ignorant of the true way of God, you will instruct them in the way of the Lord so that they'll have the faith to be born again. You're opening the eyes of the mind to see eternal realities. You are developing believers and you are bringing them to maturity. To do that, we must do everything possible to pray. We must study. We must, in fact, be filled with the Holy Ghost so that we can preach the word effectively to lead and to keep many in Christ. Let me show you an Old Testament passage that tells you the wisdom and the effectiveness that a preacher ought to have. It's in Ecclesiastes.
Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, reading from verse 9 and verse 10. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, you can't do without wisdom, he still taught the people knowledge. You must teach them knowledge. After you have finished your preaching, the people that have listened to you, they should be able to say, I didn't know this before, I know it now. I didn't see this way before, I see it now. I didn't understand that passage before, it's clear to me now. I was ignorant in that area before, now I have knowledge. You see what the scripture says here? He still taught the people knowledge. Yea, he gave good heed and sought out and set in order many principles, many proverbs. He set in order. There is a kind of organization. There is a kind of orderliness. There is a kind of arrangement in the things you are saying. You will not muddle things up. You will be very clear. Repentance before we can have real saving faith in Christ. And the saving faith will lead us into the new birth, being justified by faith. And it is the justification that will lead us into the new life. And the new life must be there before we talk about sanctification. And there must be holiness and sanctification before we encourage the people to wait and not depart from where they are until the Spirit be poured upon them. There must be something very systematic and orderly. You will not be a person that's a confused preacher yourself and confusing other people. This preacher, he gave good heed. He paid attention to the way he was ministering, and he sought out. That's in his preparation at home. You get your concordance, you get your Bible dictionary, you get your Bible as well, and you go through, you seek out, you seek out, you seek out. And when you read the word of God in preparation for preaching, you will read the passage. If you don't understand, you read it again. Then you ask yourself, what does this mean? What was the original intention and meaning of the writer that wrote it? What will the person, the immediate primary recipient of that book, what would they have understood? How is it applicable to our time today? You take time in your preparation, you seek out, and now you search in order. When you are preparing your message, this idea will come, you put it down. This idea will come, you put it down. That idea will come, you put it down. All these references are all scattered everywhere on the page, and you put everything down. And now, before you come to present it to us, you order them, you arrange them, you set them in order. You have a point number one. Before that point number one, there will be an introduction that will lead us into the real beginning of that message, and then that will go to point two. And the point two must be a natural thing that flows from point one, but it must not be the same as point one, otherwise it will be unnecessary repetition. But it will flow out of point one. Then you do your point two, and if you're going to point number three, it flows out of point two, and it is not a repetition of point two. It is not another way of saying the same thing you have said in point two. Then you come to point three, and then there must be the climax. There must be the conclusion, and the conclusion may be with a Bible story. The conclusion may be with an illustration, but the conclusion is not going to be something totally different from points 1, 2, and 3. It is to bring a summary of everything. It's to bring a conclusion of the whole thing, and then it is to make them look at the deficiency in their lives. Your conclusion will make them to see, I'm not where I ought to be. I need to pray after this message. I need to get something from the Lord after this message. Then you make your conclusion and you lead them to prayer. Look at verse 10. The preacher sought to find out acceptable words. There are some words we do not say when we are preaching. You may say there, maybe on the street, maybe when you are talking in the market, you speak pidgin English, broken English, and you try to use the words that they are using. But when you come to the pulpit, you seek for acceptable words. And then when you come to a congregation like this, we have men, we have women, there are things that are acceptable, there are things that are not acceptable. Maybe you are talking about marriage, and then you want to make an illustration. You must remember that we have teenagers here. You must remember we have single people here who are not married. Therefore, the things you say, they'll be acceptable words. And then it says that which was written was upright, even the words of truth. That's how you are to preach. And that's the thing you are to emphasize. And those are the things you are to take care of when you are obeying the injunction of the Bible that says preach the word. Each preacher must be instant in season and out of season. You see how Paul the apostle put it? He said preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. He said reprove, rebuke, exhort with all authority. And then he tells us, because the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but because they have itching ears, they will heap teachers for themselves. They will turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned unto fables. Therefore, you must understand that you are to be instant in season and out of season. That is, when it is convenient, when it is not convenient. It means that you are to always be at your post. You are to be constant in the duty of preaching. And in the details of your preaching, reprove sin without partiality. Also, reassure the people that repent with long-suffering and doctrine. Everything that is done must be done with the earnestness and the urgency that it takes, because the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. That is, they will not tolerate sound doctrine. There are backsliders that are determined and strong-willed in their backsliding. Therefore, they want fables, they want stories. And there are Nigerian preachers and African preachers that like to give entertaining things to their congregation, because really, they are not looking for their salvation. All they want is the praise of the people after they have finished their message. But it must not be like that with you. It will not be like that with you in Jesus' name. Then we come to verse 5. It says, watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, and make full proof of thy ministry. I need to emphasize something here, and I told you that I was going to take much time with point number one. You see something about Timothy. Timothy was to be a pastor. Timothy was to be an overseer. Timothy was to be a teacher, and now Timothy was to be an evangelist. You know, there are many people that will say, well, we don't really understand why we don't have evangelist apart, why we don't have a pastor apart. What they mean is, the pastor is just a pastor. He cannot teach, but he can pastor. And then they want a teacher apart. He cannot pastor, but he's a teacher. They want an evangelist apart. He cannot pastor. He cannot organize. He cannot do all the things there is to do. But, you know, he can evangelize. He can go to the field and shout and kick and jump and do everything and say, come to the Lord. After they come to the Lord, he doesn't know what to do with them. Now, if you look at Timothy, you'll find, number one, he was an overseer. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 3. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. There were people under the leadership of Timothy that he was supervising, and he was telling them, don't teach any other doctrine. He was an overseer. But number two, he was a pastor. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 14 and verse 15. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. And you know what he told him in chapter 5? How he will relate with the younger ladies, how he will relate with the older women, how he will relate with the elderly men, how he will relate with the younger men. He was a pastor as well as an overseer, but was a teacher as well. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 11, First Timothy chapter 4 verse 11, it said, these things command and teach. Timothy, you are not just a pastor, you are not just an overseer, you are not just to sit down in a chair there supervising, you are to teach. These things, what are the things? All the doctrines he has been telling him, everything he has been demonstrating before him, all that he had written to him, he said, you will command them, you will teach them intelligently, and you will teach them convincingly. He was to be an overseer, he was to be a pastor, he was to be a teacher. And now in 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 5, watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist. That means that you will be preaching to bring sinners to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do the work of an evangelist. Then he said, you must endure affliction to make full proof of your ministry. There is no faithful, fruitful ministry that is not costly. No faithful, fruitful ministry that is not costly. A painless ministry is a fruitless ministry. A painless ministry is going to be a fruitless ministry. Now we come to point number two, sacrificial service before the crown. Looking at verse 6, it said, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. He said, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but to all them also that love is appearing. These are the final words of a faithful, fruitful servant of God. And normally, generally, the final words of dying men and women are you from hypocrisy. Now they know they are leaving this realm, they are leaving this world, and they are going to the ground. And sometimes their words will either reflect faith, or reflect conviction, or Paul's final words contain no regrets. All to the Lord. In his service in the church, reserves. He didn't reserve his energy and say, I'm not going to spend all my energy on traveling, on preaching, on doing this, on doing that. I need part of my energy for recreation. I need part of my energy for enjoyment. I need part of my energy, part of my resources in politics. I need part of my resources in the world. I need part of my resources here and there. Paul the apostle had no other thing to do. He had no reserves. Everything is God. He gave to the preaching of the word of God. No wonder at the end he said, I'm now ready. You couldn't be ready if you had reserves. Because at the end of time, at the end of your life, you will be looking, the Lord will be pointing to you. You could have done this, you didn't do it. You could have saved sinners there, you didn't do it. You could have preached to people in need over there, you didn't do it. You reserved much of your energy. Now the reservation, what have you accomplished with it? But Paul the apostle said, there are no regrets, and there have been no reserves. Then as he came near to the end of his life, looking back at all he did, and looking at all he could have done, and then looking forward to the moment he will soon be standing before the Lord, he was full of joy, and he was full of a sense of fulfillment. There has been no reserves, there has been no regrets, there has been no retreat. He didn't go back. He never backslid. You find a man that just came to the Lord, and from the point he came to the Lord to the time he laid down the weapons and he said, I'm going home, I'm ready, there never was any turning back. Three important things in the life of a faithful, effective minister. No reserves. You just put everything in the ministry. All you got, you give unto it. You'll not say, well, they don't appreciate me, they are not going to say thank you, they don't appreciate sacrifice, they don't appreciate consecration, they don't appreciate, even if you die on the job, nobody is going to take care of you. You're not doing it for man.
You're not doing it for general superintendent. You're not doing it for headquarters church in Lagos. You're not doing it for anybody. You are doing it for the Almighty God. And the omniscient eyes of God are scrutinizing what you are doing. Let there be no reserves. Go at it and give everything you've got. Even if we don't say thank you. Why are we to say thank you? It says, when you have done all these things, then say, we are the unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. That's what the Lord said. Why should you be waiting for me to say thank you because you preached a good message? You didn't preach it for me. You preached it for the Lord, and you preach it to the people of God that the people might be saved. You don't need any thank you. You don't need appreciation. So, wasn't that a wonderful message? Oh, that encouraged me a lot. You know, the way the pastor talks to me, he makes me like feeling to preach again. I pity you. But what if you preach and then the people began to cry and they repent of their sins, and then I called you and I said, what a mess. See what you have done. Everybody crying. Nobody was even happy. Well, I hope you change. Then would you then go to the background and be crying and say, I preach all the message, I fasted, I read the scriptures, I explained, and those sinners, see them giving testimony that they are born again now, but the leader called me and said he didn't appreciate that. Don't look for comments of men. Just give everything you've got and say, whether they appreciate it or not, I want to do my best for the Lord. And then the Lord will give you his best when he comes. No reserves, no regrets, no retreats at all. And now you see these final words, they are not idle words. They are not words that he was just saying out of pride. Oh yes, he said I a number of times. But you understand, these are inspired scriptures. The Spirit of God inspired him to say what he said. And there is nothing wrong in this. He was just saying that this is the conviction the Spirit of the Lord is giving him. In fact, the Almighty God wants these statements to even be written down for the coming generation. Is part of inspired scripture. And there is nothing wrong with them. I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. There's no pride there, it's conviction. I have fought a good fight, it's a good testimony. I have finished my course, and that's encouragement for you and for me. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but to all them that love is appearing. I pray that your testimony will be like that on the final day in Jesus' name. That you'll not be regretting, and I know I would have spent more time for the Lord. And I know I would have given much of my resources to the Lord. Now I'm going, who am I going to leave all these things to? Then you realize that you have wasted your whole life. But there is no coming back. You are ready to go, and you are ready to go. The wise, there is still time. Now we go to point number 3. Saints and sinners in the life of a conqueror. Saints and sinners in the life of a conqueror. Paul was a conqueror. And by the time he wrote these words, the conqueror's crown was waiting for him. And though he fixed his eyes on Christ as he ran the last leg of the race, he remembered people around him. And there were kinds of people around him. You wonder, by the way, why did Paul the apostle write a long list of names? Good men, bad men, helpers, and the people that try to hinder him and discourage him, friends and foes, saints and sinners. I believe he was passing a message to Timothy, because you know, Timothy had a timid, fearful attitude or disposition. He could easily be intimidated. Timothy was a kind of person that needed encouragement, appreciation, a thank you. How are you doing there? Is everything going fine? I hope you are not feeling cold. I hope everything is going well with you. I hope the people appreciate you. I hope the church members are cooperating. That was a kind of thing that Timothy wanted. But Paul wanted to drill it into the mind and into the spine of Timothy, saying, Timothy, what did I tell you now? I told you that I have finished the course. I've run the race. I've fought a good fight. Timothy, has everybody been friendly? Has everybody been faithful?
Have they all supported me? If I waited for the people to support me, I would not have run the race to the finishing point. If I waited for everybody to cooperate, I would not have finished the race. I would not have fought a good fight. I would not have done the thing the Lord wanted me to do. He said, Timothy, let me remind you. He said in verse 10, for Demas has forsaken me. Can you imagine that? Because he had spoken about Demas as a co-laborer. He had spoken about Demas as a brother. He had spoken about Demas as a fellow worker. But he said, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. But he said, I kept moving on. Timothy, keep on moving on. You'll find one or two Demases that 1 week or 1 month or 1 year, they'll be very friendly. They'll be working together with you. They'll be smiling. They'll be cooperating. The other time, you'll find that they're going to leave you because they love this present world. But Timothy, you know what I did? I shot all those things away from my eyes. I kept on looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. And that's what I did. I kept on looking at the Lord. Timothy, don't you be discouraged if you have one Demas or another fellow that leaves you. What I've done is what you should do. And then he said, Christians to Galatians and Titus unto Dalmatia. And this Titus, his name comes up often and often and often. In fact, in 2 Corinthians alone, his name is mentioned 9 times. In Galatians, his name is mentioned 2 times. And Paul called him my own son after the common faith. He left him in Crete that he will be able to set things in order and appoint people. He was one of the faithful people. Then he mentioned Luke. Only Luke is with me. Now, when he said only Luke is with me, he was not saying it. You know, there are 2 ways you can say that. You can say it in the sense that everybody is gone. I'm lonely here. In fact, only Luke, can you imagine? Only Luke is not worth much. He cannot do much, but only Luke is here. That's the way you can say it that way. But what he was saying, he wasn't saying it with the tone of pity. He was saying, Titus is doing something. I sent him to go and do it. The work is going on there. The work is good. I make everybody to be busy. I don't make everybody to be staying with me and licking my tears and wiping my tears and sympathizing with me and, you know, getting around me and saying, Paul, what a pity. See what you are going through. No, I sent them all out. I said, don't stay with me. See, are there, go and preach to them. Only Luke I kept with me. Only Luke is with me. Who was Luke? He was that physician by profession, but God used him as a capable historian that gave detailed accounts of the early ministry of Christ. You know, he was the one that wrote the gospel according to Luke. And then also he wrote Acts of the Apostles. He was a loving, loyal companion. And then he spoke about others in verse 11. Mark, take Mark and bring him with thee. You know Mark, that's John Mark. At the beginning, John Mark was a kind of a jellyfish. He didn't have backbone to his conviction. And he had followed Barnabas and Paul in the first missionary journey. But when the going got tough, John Mark went back. And then eventually, when they were still to visit for follow-up, Paul the apostle said, let him go back, he's not ready. Let him go back, he cannot endure. Let him go back, he's not ready yet. He doesn't have the backbone, the iron constitution, the determination. He doesn't have what it takes on the mission field. Let him stay at home in Jerusalem. And of course, there was a misunderstanding, but the scriptures and the Holy Spirit and God and history and the church justified Paul the apostle. Because Barnabas went without any comment that it was the church that chose anybody for him. But Paul the apostle, Silas was recommended to him by the church. And then he continued the work. But at this time now, John Mark had changed. John Mark had become more matured. And because of that, he said, take John Mark with you because it's profitable for the ministry. And then he says in verse 12, Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. You know, Paul the apostle, he didn't send them, he didn't make them to stay around him, pitying him, licking his wounds. He sent them away to be preaching. The cloak which I left in Troas with Carpus, when thou comest, bring with thee. And the books, but especially the parchments. You know, at his old age, when he was still about to die, he was still wanting to read. He said, bring those books when you are coming. And then bring that blanket to the cloak I left, because it's so cold here in this dungeon. Maybe I can get that and wrap myself and have a little convenience. But when you are coming, bring the books, those spiritual books, especially the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith, he did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Was he cursing him? No. All he was saying is, you will reap what you sow. This is what this man sowed. And there is the law of sowing and reaping. He hindered, he opposed the word of God, whom in verse 12 or in verse 15, of whom be thou ware also. For he has greatly withstood our words. What pained Paul the apostle is that he withstood the word of truth. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that he may not be laid to their charge. You see, when it's a personal offense, he said, God, forgive them. But when it is something touching the gospel, touching sound doctrine, touching the word of God, he said, that man, he opposed our word. He will not allow the people to believe the truth. God will have to deal with that man, because that man touched the truth of God. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered from the mouth of the lion. What a testimony. He said, I don't need anybody to pity me. In fact, I'm so grateful to the Lord. I am delivered from the mouth of the lion, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work. Amen. And we will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. He said, don't forget, Timothy, if I don't see Priscilla and Aquila again, you must greet them for me. Those people, we labor together, we pray together. They gave their house, and we had a church in their house. And the people in Galatia and other provinces, they spoke well about them. Please tell them, if I don't meet them here, we'll meet up yonder. And don't you forget the household of Onesiphorus and Erastus. He is abiding in Corinth. But Trophimus, I left sick at Miletus. I wish I could get back there and take care of him. This man was in the prison. He was in the Roman prison at this time. He was in the dungeon himself. And they were about to chop off his head because of the kind of persecution at that time. He still remembered the people that were sick. Then he said, Timothy, do thy diligence to come before winter. I'm going to ask you a question. Now, Paul was about to die, and he thought in the whole world, the person he would like to see last, just before going. And he said, Timothy, I've thought about all the people I've met, all the people I've seen, all the people I've interacted with, all the people I have taught, all the people I've worked together with, and I cannot think of any other person I must see before I die. He said, Timothy, you must come. Just to see you, your faith, your commitment, your love. I know you are not strong, but I know the grace of God in you. Timothy, I must see you. You must come. Before I leave, do thy diligence to come before winter. I'm going to ask you another question. Suppose, just suppose, that the Lord tarries and I were to leave before you. Are you one of the people I would say, where is brother so-and-so? Before I see Jesus face to face, I must see brother so-and-so. But if today, while we are together, I don't see you for 1 year, it doesn't concern you. Maybe it doesn't concern me. I don't even remember that you are there. And you are not eager to see me. You are self-sufficient. You can preach, you can heal, you can do everything. And you don't worry about no fellowship between us. You benefit when I preach, you listen to cassettes, I know that. There is no fellow feeling, no heart-to-heart affection. I'm looking for you, I can't see you. And maybe eventually out of sight is out of mind. I'll say, well, he likes to go on his own way. He likes to be isolated. He likes to do whatever. After all, he has become an overseer, has become a great leader. And he feels self-sufficient. Are you one of the people that when, if Jesus tarries, I'm going, I'll say, Lord, give me a minute before you come. Let me see brother so-and-so. Let me see sister so-and-so. And then after he told him, he said, the Lord Jesus Christ be with thy spirit. And he ended the way he started. Grace be with you. At the beginning, he said, grace and peace and mercy be with you. He said, I obtained grace from the Lord. I did those things in ignorance. He said, I am what I am by the grace of God. He said, the grace of God made me a master builder. Before he died, grace was on his lips. And while he pronounced grace, he passed from earth and went to the great beyond. It's all of grace. Rise up and pray. Preach the word. There's nothing else to preach. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Because the time has come when many people are not enduring sound doctrine. They have itching ears, they are heaping to themselves teachers of false doctrines. They are gathered unto fables. But you stand by the word, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of your ministry, focus your attention on the goal that the Lord has set before you, on the work he has given you to do. Do it. Do it. Don't allow anything to distract your attention. No reserves, no retreat, no regret. Keep on preaching, keep on moving on, keep on doing it until you see the Lord face to face. Commit yourself to preaching the word. Don't take away from the word and don't add to the word. So that when the final hour will come, you live in this world. You'll be able to give a testimony like that of Paul the Apostle. I'm now ready. Ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth from now, a crown of righteousness is waiting for me. Not only for me, but for all them that love is appearing. The grace of our Lord be with your spirit.